Captain's log, stardate 54121.3. The Excelsior is being posted to Deep Space 12, where I'll be taking command of the sector from an old friend, Jennifer Cole.
So Ian, how are you?
Could be better. Starfleet seems to think that throwing an inexperienced crew on a dreadnought with a veteran captain will make an exceptional crew out of them.
I know what you mean. So what is going on? Why would Starfleet put you out here in the middle of nowhere?
There have been some unconfirmed reports of alien activity out past the Briar Patch, maybe connected to the encounter I had during the war. The Excelsior is going out to check some regions similar to the McAllister Nebula where we were attacked.
It sounds like you're just jumping right back into the nightmare.
I've always believed in facing my fears, Jen.
I seem to recall hearing something about that, but nothing ever came of it.
Starfleet was too busy with Dominion politics to do a thorough investigation at the time. Besides, there wasn't much left of the alien ship to investigate. We didn't recover any of the alien corpses.
Wasn't Dr. Hengler a member of that mission?
He served under me for 3 years.
Well, station is all yours, Captain. Oh, you might want to have maintenance take a look at that replicator. It's been giving me fits for the last 3 weeks. I'll be serving on the Angelus, so it's quite possible we might not see each other again for maybe another 10 years.
That's what Fleet is all about. I just wish you and Johnny had stayed closer.
Well, we wrote to each other from time to time whenever we could. But then we got our own commands and just drifted apart. Then it was too late.
Sometimes I think about what happened. My brother was smart, but he wasn't always careful. Those Dominion bastards killed him without thinking about it. I can't help wishing I'd been there to stop them.
Ian, there wasn't anything you could have done. There wasn't anything any of us could have done. I should know.
It's hard when you lose family.
The war affected us all. But sometimes you just have to let the past go.
I'm glad you and Janice are still around.
And there's another of our classmates around, too. You remember John Lane?
Yeah, the class clown, as I recall.
Well, I'd better be getting over to the Angelus. Take good care of my station, Ian.
Enter. Captain, may I introduce Lieutenant Commander Jason Munoz? He'll be your new first officer.
Great. More kids on my ship.
With all due respect, sir, I am the best person for this job. All I ask for is a chance to prove it.
No offense, Lieutenant Commander. I've heard it all before. We're talking about a combat-ready galaxy-class dreadnought here, not the flimsy space tug you probably trained on. I need someone who won't fold under pressure.
I've seen combat under Captain Wilcox. My record should speak for itself, even without the captain's recommendation.
Captain Wilcox's recommendation got you this chance. It's up to you to keep it.
You won't be disappointed, sir.
We've completed the rest of the assignment changes. I put our best people in the Excelsior.
I want all personnel to review the information we have about the attack. Then set up a meeting for 0700 tomorrow.
Isn't that a little early, sir?
Not in my book, Commander. Make it happen.
Aye, sir.
Mr. Munoz, I want you to go over to the Excelsior and start overseeing things. The ship's brand new and she's still being put through the hoops. Get acquainted with the crew. You need to earn their trust even more than you need to earn mine.
Yes, sir.
In the meantime, I think I'll pay a visit to that Iconian fellow. How do you pronounce his name? Raven?
Raven, sir.
Just so.
Come in.
Raven?
That is correct.
I've heard good things about you, Raven.
I've gone over those files you wanted me to. I have some rather unsettling news. They're called the Great Confederacy. It's a collection of genetically engineered species run by a powerful sonic race known as the Ethereals. They were the mortal enemies of the Iconians, and it was they who bombarded the Iconian homeworld into oblivion.
You said the Grey disappeared several thousand years ago, but no one knows where they went?
That is correct. The Grey are an elusive race who come out of hiding to attack a civilization or to abduct an individual, and then go back into hiding. All of their species are long-lived and can serve the Grey for centuries before having to be replaced.
With their attack upon us in the McAllister Nebula, it would appear they've decided to take a more direct approach.
If the Grey have decided to take an offensive tact with the Federation, they may be unstoppable. Even the Iconians were incapable of such a feat.
No offense, but the Iconians were destroyed by the Grey over 2,000 years ago. I think we've advanced a little since then.
What you fail to realize, Captain, is that 2,000 years ago, the Iconians were more advanced than the Federation is today.
We've defeated the Borg and the Dominion. I think you'd be surprised at how resourceful the Federation can be.
So what's the connection between the Nebula and the Briar Patch?
I suspect it could have something to do with their biomechanical hull plating. Both the Briar Patch and the McAllister Nebula have high concentrations of metaphasic particles, which could increase the strength of their hull plating. If they leave the patch, they could become more susceptible to damage from an attacker.
We'll work from that hypothesis. Our goal will be to lure the Grey out of the patch in any confrontation we have with them. In the meantime, I'd like to pursue peaceful and diplomatic resolutions to the situation. We need to establish a dialogue with them if we're going to get anywhere.
First olive branch?
Something like that. Raven, I want you to work with Counselor Elbury on such a concept.
Sir, it's a waste of time. The Grey do not negotiate. They do what they want, they take what they want.
We have to be able to order their surrender, don't we?
As you wish, Captain.
Also, I'd like you to provide Dr. Henglar with all the information you have on the different species that make up the Grey Confederacy. He needs to be ready for anything.
I'll forward that information to you, Doctor.
Thank you.
Mr. Munoz, I need that status report on the Excelsior. Hop to it, Number One.
Right away, sir.
Sir, I'm having a problem lining the torque sensors. Could be a problem with the bioneural gel packs again.
First things first. This is my first stint as chief engineer. Call me chief, not sir. I may know warp dynamics better than most men, but I am definitely no sir.
Whatever you say, chief.
And you're right, it probably is the gel packs. I don't know why they invented them anyway. Leffler's law number 123. If it works perfectly, someone will redesign it. I'll take hardwired circuitry any day.
So what do we do?
Take the gel pack out and rewire it with isolinear circuits.
That'd take forever, Chief.
On second thought, just call me Leffler.
You got it, Leffler.
Who's in charge here?
I am, Lieutenant Commander Robin Leffler, and this is my assistant chief engineer, Lieutenant Toby Witzek. You must be the new first officer.
Lieutenant Commander Jason Munoz. It's nice to meet you. I understand you served aboard the Enterprise.
Yes, sir. Commander LaForge taught me everything I know.
How's the shakedown coming along?
We were just about to replace a bad bioneural circuit.
We?
You served under Knapp during the war, is that right?
Yes, sir. Right out of the Academy.
I made it a point to read everyone's file that was on the Devonshire. Can you tell us anything about your experience with the Grey?
Want to know the truth, sir? I've never been so afraid in my entire life. When they take over your mind, you have no control of your actions. It's like watching a hollow movie with
without being able to control the story.
I'd like to go over that in detail with you later. In the meantime, it's good to have you aboard.
Thank you, sir.
Keep me posted, Leffler. I'll be around the ship if you need me.
The ship will be ready, sir.
Carry on.
Let's get this gel pack replaced. Leffler's Law number 17. When all else fails, do it yourself.
So, would you like to join me for a drink when we're done?
Don't start, Witzek. You're not my type.
I'm sorry, sir.
Leffler's Law number 22, never date a coworker. Besides, I'm sure there's lots of other women on the ship who would love to have a drink with you. Come on, the gel pack awaits.
We'll have 1,200 people aboard when the crew rotation is finished.
To be perfectly honest, Counselor, I think I'd go insane if I had to listen to that many voices.
It's not so bad. It's pretty easy to tune them out.
I suppose it's pretty hard to read my emotions.
Actually, you're one of the easiest to read. You only wish you were hard to read.
Must be my charming personality that gives me away.
But deep inside, you're one of the most compassionate people around.
I can just see myself now as ship's counselor. I sense you're feeling disturbed. Get over it!
Doctor, Ensign Capel sprained his ankle again. He's waiting for you.
Damn it! I've told that boy not to go snowboarding in the holodeck 3 times this month alone. Have Dr. Anderson look at him.
You did the same thing when you were his age, and a nice doctor was always there to fix you up.
And that's why I'm sending him to Dr. Anderson. She's the only nice doctor we have aboard.
I'll remember that for next time.
Will that be all, Doctor?
Yes. Thank you, nurse.
Hiya, Doc.
Oh, God, spare us all. He's changed colors again. Well, I dare say red is a fitting color for the lad.
I think so. He's sure proud about it.
Like, that's hard to tell, Counselor.
And I was afraid it had gone to his head.
Too late for that.
Hey!
Seriously, though, congratulations, Lieutenant Commander. Seems like just yesterday I was teaching your academy class in tactical psychology.
So, why did you stop teaching?
They needed more telepaths for the Dominion War. Once I got out here, I found I liked it. I've been out here ever since.
Well, it's nice to have you aboard.
Well, if you'll excuse me, I have patients to deal with.
I better finish my rounds. I'll see you two later. Bye.
Jace, hey, I knew you'd turn red someday. I was just getting familiar with the new science officer, Ensign Roe Nevin.
Sir.
Roe, that wouldn't be any relation to Roe Laren, would it?
She's my sister. Still stubborn as a horse, sir.
I believe that's stubborn as a mule, Mr. Nevin.
He's Bajoran. They go by last name first.
Oh, my mistake. Ensign Roe.
Welcome aboard. So, Jenna, how they pry you off the Olympus? I thought you liked it there.
Well, actually, Commander Johns convinced me that I was needed here. Everybody else wanted to stay.
And how's Corey Astor?
He's all right. The captain of the Olympus is a really sweet Brickar woman. She treats her entire crew like family. Oh, and Brickmeyer is out on leave because he got into a nasty run-in with a Nausicaan. I know. He's messed up. He'll be all right.
I miss working with you. Now, this reminds me of our academy days. I'm really going to enjoy working with you again, Jenna.
Hey, we should go out for some jamja sometime.
I wouldn't miss it.
Ensign Roe, see you on the bridge.
So where was I?
The koi pond.
Right. I have bought 2 pounds of fresh gach off a Uridian dealer and dumped a lot of it into Boothby's pond. You should have seen the look on Boothby's face when he discovered that his carefully bred koi had been replaced by jumping gach.
My sister was a mischief maker, too. I was never allowed anything like that. I always had to be the good one. Straight A's in math and science.
See, it's the girls that are the real troublemakers. Boys can't get away with it anymore.
The mischievous women and the men who envy them.
Welcome aboard the Excelsior, sir.
At ease, Lieutenant. Name and position, Lieutenant.
Lieutenant William Martinez, sir. Chief of Security.
What's the status of our weapon systems, Lieutenant?
We have a full load of torpedoes, and our phasers were just recently overhauled.
And what steps are you taking to combat hostile invasion of the ship?
I've already spoken with Raven. We're retuning all the hand phasers to be more effective against the aliens' bio-armor.
Carry on. Name and position, Ensign.
Brad Rollins, sir. Communications.
Rollins, I understand you and Roe went to the academy together.
Yes, sir. And Ensign Barrett, too, sir.
It's good to have classmates around, isn't it?
Yes, sir. We work well together.
Is this your first assignment, Ensign?
Second, sir. After the academy, I served at Starfleet Command on Earth. Admiral Vieck recommended me for the position.
Very good, Ensign. Keep an eye on those comm signals.
Sir, operations ready, sir.
Glad to hear it, Mr.
Barrett, Andrew J., Chief of Operations.
I've read your file. A couple of minor infractions while at the academy, but an excellent record since. Keep it that way, and we'll get along just fine.
Yes, sir.
Captain on the bridge.
Nothing like a little surprise inspection.
Would you like to take a tour, sir?
No time for that, number one. Please accompany me to my ready room.
There's been another attack on the Corinthius system. This time a colony ship, lost with all hands. Starfleet wants us underway immediately. I just hope we can figure out what they're up to. Otherwise, there may be no stopping them this time.